Hi, I'm Terry Stewart with the Department of Animal Sciences at Purdue University. Tibia Hemimelia, or typically goes under the name of just TH, is a condition where you have a small body, a very severe shortening of the limbs, especially in the hind end, has been seen a little bit recently in the shorthorn breed of cattle. The Shorthorn Breed Association can do a pedigree search and tell you whether your animals are suspect of this particular defect. And there is also a genetic test available through various testing labs where you can send in a DNA sample to verify whether an animal is a carrier or not. Contractural arachnodactyly is a new genetic condition by name, but it's been talked about the last few years. It's the one we've been calling fawn calf. The American Angus Association just announced last week, which was July 20th, so you know which week we're talking about, that a genetic test will soon be available for this particular condition, which again is another single locus recessive condition. The trait is characterized by calves at birth having a very fawn-like appearance. They tend to be frail. They have a little bit of a hunched appearance and kind of a hoppity gait, very reminiscent of a deer fawn. Main thing is to check with the breed associations to stay up to date on when this genetic test will actually be available in the laboratories. It's my understanding that several of the AI companies have already released information on the carrier status of sires that are available in their lineup. So you may, if you've been utilizing AI sires, you may want to check with your semen supplier and see what information they could give you. Here is an example of hydrocephalus in cattle. Hydrocephalus occurs in all mammals. That's why we put the picture of the little chihuahua down there, just as a pointer that it occurs in all mammals. Hydrocephalus is also called water on the brain. It is typically controlled by a single locus allele. There's also the condition called neuropathic hydrocephalus that's been occurring specifically in the Angus breed that's related to this condition. There is a genetic marker for neuropathic hydrocephalus. There's not a general genetic marker for all types of hydrocephalus available today. If you're having concerns that some of your cattle may be carriers of neuropathic hydrocephalus, check with the breed association first, and you can do a pedigree search. And then if the animal is suspect based on the pedigree search, there are labs that can do a genetic test for you. Arthrogyposis multiplexus, or better known as curly calf, because it's hard to say all those other words, has recently become of concern in the Angus breed, and a lot of public attention has been paid to it. As you'll see in the lower right-hand side, there's a picture of a white calf that's also exhibiting the same phenotype. So it's not really a new condition. It's just one that we're starting to understand. There is now a genetic marker available to test carriers, to identify carriers for this particular trait. The place to start would be with your breed association. They can do a pedigree search to tell if your particular animals would be suspect carriers. If they are suspect, then you can do a genetic testing, send a little blood into a genetic lab. They can do a testing for you and confirm whether an animal is a carrier or free of this condition. It's not uncommon to get a call from a cattle producer who's asking the question, do I have a genetic problem? Abnormal phenotypes can be caused by both genetic and environmental factors, and it's not always easy to tell them apart. First place to start is what is already known, and there's actually an excellent resource called the Online Mendelian Inheritance in Animals, which is a mouthful, or OMIA, and we're showing the link to that on the slide. Easiest thing to do is just to Google OMIA, and it's usually always the first link that comes up. This is a resource maintained by Sydney University in Australia, and has all the references that are known anywhere in the world to genetic defects in all types of animals. So you can go in and search cattle, and you can search for the defect and find out what we already know. Another good place is to check with your breed association to see what they already know about the defect. Having given those information, if you haven't resolved the problem, you then have to start figuring out, is this probably a genetic factor or is this an environmental issue? The first thing is probably to find out, is it occurring only in one family? If it's only in a specific sire family, that would give you indications that there's probably a genetic origin, but it doesn't mean it definitely is. Also, you might ask if the animal's inbred, because inbred animals have increased homozygosity, and since most genetic defects are associated with recessive alleles, increasing in the homozygosity is going to increase the expression of deleterious genetic traits. But what you really have to do is do some detective work to find out what's different about those affected animals. We have a lot of abnormal phenotypes that can be caused by hormonal imbalances that might be from moldy feeds. It could be from toxins that the animals were subjected to, especially pregnant females. And so if while the fetus was in utero, was the female exposed to some stressor or some toxic defect that might have caused that animal to develop improperly. There's also just random events where we have animals that don't develop properly. You hear people talk about two-headed calves or calves with extra feet. And quite frequently, these are caused by some unknown environmental defect or just a developmental defect that didn't quite go right. What do you do if you suspect you have a genetic defect in an animal in your herd? Probably the first thing to do is take pictures. Take lots of pictures because that way you can share them and people have knowledge about defects can look at those pictures and give an awful lot of information. You want to be able to collect a blood sample or a hair sample, and if it's a hair sample, make sure you get one that's including the roots because that's really where the DNA is. You want to be having material that you can have for DNA testing. Also collect samples from the parents too if they're available because that'll help you start to establish a family relationship. You should contact your breed association and report the issue to them. You can describe it to them, probably send them some of those pictures that you've taken. And representative of the breed association can tell you if it's a problem that is prevalent in the breed or if it's never occurred before. So a lot of information can come from your breed association. If possible, have a veterinarian examine the animal. If the animal's already dead, they may actually want to do some gross anatomy as far as to see what else might be wrong with the animal. Quite frequently, if an animal has a defect, it's expressed in several ways in the phenotype. So being able to document all of the abnormal phenotypic characteristics of that animal would be helpful in elucidating whether it was a genetic defect or not, or whether it may have been something that was caused by a non-genetic factor.
This presentation was a production of the Animal Science Department at Purdue University.